Hello, faithful politics listeners and watchers. If you're joining us via YouTube, this is Josh Bertram, your faithful host, and we have the ever political host, Will. Hi, Will. Good to be with you today. Yeah, I feel like I haven't seen your face in a million years, so it's so good to see it again.
Well, just a reminder, we do have a YouTube channel, so if you ever miss seeing my face, you can just go to our YouTube channel.
I could do that, but that doesn't have the natural, you know. But anyway, today we have on our show Dr. John Johnson, Dr. John Jackson, sorry, Dr. John Jackson. He's the sixth president of William Jessup University in Rockland, California. Since becoming president in 2011, John has led the university to triple in its size. They've added math, sciences, and arts graduate programs and online programs to its curricular offerings and become regionally and nationally ranked by U.S. News and World Report and the Chronicle of Higher Education. And he has a goal for the students to become equipped and known. Dr. Jackson has demonstrated strong communication, strategic, and organizational leadership skills in his work with national and global organizations and ministries. He's written and co-authored 9 books on leadership and spiritual formation and is a sought-after speaker and consultant. John earned his PhD in MA in Educational Administration and Organizational Studies from the University of California, Santa Barbara. His MA is in Theology, Christian Formation, and Discipleship from Fuller Theological Seminary, and his BA is in Religion, Christian History, and Thought from Chapman University. He is married to Pamela, and they have 5 children and 4 grandchildren, and they make their home in Northern California. Dr. Johnson has also been the pastor of different churches in California, like Bayside Church in Granite Bay, and was also the executive director of Thriving Churches International. So thank you so much for being on the program with us, Dr. Jackson. You told me I could call you John after I called you Dr. Jackson. So all formalities aside.
that's John. And I'll tell you what, man, I love that you guys are both brave and bold and courageous and just reasonable human beings, because it used to be that what we'd say is this: just don't ever, in a social setting, don't ever talk about politics or religion.
Exactly.
And you guys are going, wait a minute, like, where did that rule come from? We should be able to talk and be reasonable people. And so I just love what you guys are doing and super happy to be part of the conversation.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here. You know, our goal is to make Thanksgiving dinners very difficult for people as they come together. That's kind of our goal. So no, I really appreciate it. Well, thank you so much, John. So tell the audience a little bit, how did you get to the place where you are as president of Jessup University, and who is John Jackson? How did you get to where you are today?
Well, thanks so much. And again, Josh and Will, appreciate the privilege to be with your audience. For me, to be honest, when I hear that resume, I get a little bit tired and then a little bit thinking like, yeah, well, I definitely am not all that in a bag of chips. But let me just tell you the basic journey. I was born and raised in a Baptist pastor's home in Southern California, wanted to be a pro baseball player, got to the point when I was 15, had a life crisis. Man, I'm really, really good. My whole life was about Jesus and books. I was good in school and sports. And I wanted to be a pro baseball player, got to 15, was really analytical, figured I'm good, but I'm not great. And I knew that only great ball players made it in the pros. So it sounds weird, but age 15, had a life crisis. And so as I was having that life crisis, God, what do you want me to do? I just said, God, I will never, ever be a missionary or a pastor. Age 16, about 6 months later, clear call of God in my life. I want you to serve me full time with your life as a pastor. So let me accelerate. I served a church in Southern California as a youth pastor. Then I became a staff pastor. And then we had a pastor resign in a setting that was full of moral failure, just a real tragedy. And then what happened is I became, at age 26, that same church, the senior pastor, almost a 90-year-old Baptist church, 300-400 people, a lot of pain, a lot of struggles. Like, how could this happen that our leader fell? They say that what doesn't kill you will make you stronger. And that's kind of my story of that church. And then we left that. I became a denominational leader at a super young age, about 31. That was an amazing journey. But we really missed the local church. So we moved to Nevada, planted a local church. God did miraculous things. 13 years right outside of Carson City, and just had such a treasured time. and then ultimately came over here thinking that I was going to co-pastor or help lead Bayside Church and then start Thriving Churches International, and some good stuff happened. But I was minding my own business, guys, minding my own business, trying to do what Jesus asked me to do. And then God just worked a series of circumstances, and I became the president of Jessup University back in 2011. Wow. So I'm in my 13th year, and higher ed is a rough sector, and faith-based ed is really challenging. But faith-based higher ed in California provides some unique challenges. But you know what? God is faithful. And everybody's story's like that. Like you had stuff that was planned out. You kind of felt like you architected it. You set your sights
absolutely
on it.
Absolutely.
And then there's other stuff in life where it just, you take a turn and you didn't plan on it. And that financial, medical, relational thing happened. And just as long as you keep holding on to Jesus, amazing stuff can happen. So I've been here, I'm in my 13th year, and God's just been so good. And my wife, Pam, and I have been married. We got married super young. So if I just say what's the key to my life, it's Jesus. It's my wife, and it's my family. And, that everything else has kind of fallen in line from that.
And so you wrote a book recently called Grace Ambassador, Bringing Heaven to Earth. I'd love to have you maybe give us a top level overview of what it's all about, because I mean, especially in today's day and age, it feels like grace is often missing from the equation, whether you are a believer, non-believer, what have you, and especially kind of in the world of politics. I mean, that's sort of the world I live and breathe on a daily basis. So tell us about Grace Ambassador.
Yeah, so good. I tell this story at the beginning of the book. I won't take a long time, but sometimes I write books that are like in my soul, and I got to write it quick. This one was about 13 years in the making. I grew up Baptist. I love my Baptist heritage. So grateful. Good foundation on the Word of God. Good passion for reaching people who don't know Jesus. But honestly, I was a super big truth guy. Not so big on the grace side. So, the law came through Moses, but Jesus came full of grace and truth. Me, high on the truth side, kind of low on the grace side. And God just taught me that over the years. But about 13 years ago, I was reading the Lord's Prayer. You know, Our Father, which art in heaven. People have prayed that, said that, read that. I had taught on it for years as a pastor. And while I was doing that, I had this experience where I felt like God was stopping me. I didn't hear an audible voice, but I felt like God was stopping me. And there was a certain phrase where he said to me, "You don't believe that." Now, usually when I read the Bible, I'm like reading it devotionally. I want God to speak to me. But I was reading the Bible, and I felt clearly like God was saying, "You don't believe that." This was the phrase, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." I've been married, I'll be 44 years this August and another few weeks. And for me, to be honest, I buy cards for my wife to cry. If I can buy the right kind of card that I can find in a store as a dude who's, I always tell husbands, man, we're always like in the deficit. So anything you can do to get husband points, man, do it.
Heck yeah.
If I can buy a card that makes my wife like get emotional, it's like, yes. But she knows and I know that the sentiments in the card and the actual everyday reality there's going to be a gap there. So when I was reading, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," I was like going like, okay, that's a cool Hallmark card sentiment, if I could say that, but reality is never on earth as it is in heaven. Well, what does that have to do with Grace Ambassador? I just started diving in and saying, okay, Lord, what if Jesus actually meant what he said? How does heaven get to earth? And here's my answer. Heaven came to earth in Jesus. When Jesus came, was born on the planet of refugee parents, when he walked the dusty trails of the very earth he created, when he hung on the cross because of his great love for us, that was grace. God's unmerited favor for all of us, man. No matter how good you are or how bad you are, Jesus is for all of us. So then I started thinking, okay, heaven on earth. What does it mean? Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So here's what I think, Will and Josh. I think that we have the opportunity to bring the grace, the love, the kindness, compassion of Jesus into everyday atmospheres. And actually, if you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, it says this: we are ambassadors of reconciliation. The reason I didn't use the word, you know, reconciliation ambassadors is I thought it'd be harder for people to grab hold of. So grace ambassadors, we bring God's heart, God's loving, compassionate heart. I just believe that people like me, who are good, strong followers of Jesus, often so hate the world, often are so angry at the world, that we lose God's redemptive, loving, grace-filled heartbeat. So that's really the passion of the book. Be an ambassador of God's grace and kindness to a world that desperately needs hope, desperately needs love, desperately needs forgiveness.
You know, I'm wondering if maybe you can expand on one of the things that you said. You mentioned, you know, Jesus dying is sort of this act of grace. And, you know, I'm sure there's someone out there listening to this who has no faith background, no, you know, no belief system, or maybe they're an atheist, agnostic, and they hear Jesus hanging from a cross is a sign of grace. And like, and so I often tell our audience that I came to the faith back in 2008, and I've spent more of my life as a atheist and non-believer than I have a believer. So if someone had said something like that to me, I would just look at them like they were crazy, because I'm like, that makes no sense whatsoever. So maybe, yep, like, maybe you can expand on what you mean by Jesus hanging a cross as a, is sort of an example of grace.
So good. And before I do, let me say this. If in your audience or in our everyday experience, we don't recognize that an increasing number of people don't have like a grand narrative of like what's life about, they have a different worldview, or sometimes they use the analogy of sunglasses, man. You put amber shaded sunglasses on, the whole world looks amber shaded. We all have a set of glasses through which we look at life. So here's what I'd say, Will, to maybe make a little bit more sense of that. This is what I believe, this is what I think the Bible teaches, but I also think most of us have experienced it in life. Life is not perfect, right? Pre-1970s, a lot of people used to write utopian stories about the future. Future's gonna be utopia, it's gonna be perfect. Now everybody writes what's called dystopian things. The whole world's gonna end in chaos, it's just a question of how it ends. Most everybody knows the world's not perfect. But I would just submit this to you, and it's a long conversation. If there's a God, there may not be, but if there's a God, that God surely is perfect. And if God's perfect and we're not, everyday human beings like us, Josh, Will, and John on this call, on this experience, are not perfect. If there's a God who's perfect and we're not, there's a gap between us and God. Well, the Bible teaches that there is a God, that he's perfect, and his perfection means he can't be in relationship. He can't be in connection with anyone or anything that's not perfect. He can't be bonded to or connected. So the Bible story is this, is that it was perfect at creation. Then there was a fall, a mess up. We all messed up. You know, you could look at people in your house and go, they've messed up, I've messed up. When human beings messed up, that created that gap between us and God. What God did is, instead of giving every single one of us what we deserve, which is to be forever separated from him, to be forever like apart from God, what God did is, in an act of what the Bible calls amazing grace or unimaginable grace, is that God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross. When Jesus was hanging on that cross, he wasn't hanging there because he was imperfect. He wasn't hanging there because he had done something that was deserving. He was hanging there as a perfect human being, never once sinned. And he hung on that cross as the payment, as the gap mender between us and God. And so when we talk about grace and Jesus dying on the cross, it's like he died in my place, your place. He paid the penalty. If I told you tomorrow that you own $10 million, you owe that money, and if you don't pay that money, you're going to die. Well, both of you maybe are so wealthy that you have that kind of money. I don't have that kind of money.
Clearly.
But if you said, you owe $10 million and I'm going to die tomorrow, I'd spend today, you know, saying goodbye to my friends and to my family. But what if I said you owe $1 billion? Probably you guys couldn't even hang with that. Or what if I said you owe $100 billion? Well, now you owe $1 trillion. whatever number it is that just so takes it off the charts. You owe a debt that you could never pay. That debt that you could never pay was paid by somebody who didn't owe a debt. That's what grace is. God showed each one of us his undeserved but amazing favor and kindness. He wiped out our debt. Now all we have to do is say, I choose to be reunited to God. But the Bible calls it a step of faith. We say, I put my faith and trust in what God did for me when Jesus went to the cross. That's what grace is all about. And by the way, grace is also about, if you mess up in my life, Josh, and you do something where you go like, oh, let's reverse it, it's probably me. I mess up and do something really bad to you.
No, and
offend you and hurt you and, you know, like do something wrong. I take money from you or somehow do that. And you go like, man, I'm totally offended. I like, you messed up, man. Dude, you owe me. If you were to come to me and go, look, John, I know you messed up. Maybe you didn't mean to. Or maybe you did. Maybe you just messed up. I'm just going to totally grant you complete forgiveness. Even if I never deserved that, even if I like didn't earn that, that would be an example of you having great grace on me where you forgive me even though I've done nothing to restore or that, like, wow, that's what grace is. And it happens mostly between God and us, but we also can give grace to one another.
Yeah, we have to give grace to one another. I love that. It's beautifully said in the simple representation of the gospel. And I love the analogies you use and the metaphors, and it's so good. How do I, as like an individual, you had mentioned it at the end, but like I've received this grace from God, you know, and, or even like I've received this grace from God, right? So now I have to be this ambassador, right? Someone who's going in, almost like a conveyor of grace to others as that I receive. This is kind of a two-sided question. Number one, how do I do that? Like, I have my neighbors that I look out this window here from my office, and I can see them yelling at each other sometimes, and, you know, mowing the lawn, and I look all around, and I'm like, okay, well, I know what I believe, but there's a whole nother universe next door. How do I even begin to, you know, make headway into that universe through grace? And why has it been that so many Christians have not put grace forward? Or maybe it's just bad PR from the media. What do you think?
Two big questions, and you guys need to
cut me
off. I just
like throwing softballs at you, John. I just love.
You guys need to cut me off if I get going too strong. Let me start with your second question first. I think most of us have been deceived. And here's the deception I want to point out. We're probably all deceived in a lot of ways, but here's one of them. We have bought the lie that in life there's what I call a sacred secular divide. We've bought the lie that when I do religious stuff, when I go to church, when I go serve in a mission or something like that, when I pray at home, that's spiritual. But then if I'm out mowing the lawn or walking the dog or at my work in the cubicle or in the delivery truck or in the C-suite or wherever your work takes you, when I'm kind of hanging out with my spouse or girlfriend, boyfriend, or best friend, or like, that's secular. And I really think that's a distortion and a deception. And to be frank, now I'm an evangelical Protestant. I've been in all kinds of different church settings. But to be honest, those of us who are pastors and missionaries have kind of reinforced that. We've told people, man, that Sunday morning thing is it. And by the way, I'm totally supportive of that Sunday morning thing. On the other hand, I don't think that's it. I think like all of life is it. So that sacred secular divide is the first thing. The second thing is, you mentioned the media. There have been studies on this, and you guys would recognize this, especially if we talk about politics. Four words: mean, angry, condemning, and judgmental. Mean, angry, condemning, judgmental. That's how the media's portrayed Christians. Mean, angry, condemning, judgmental.
How can we make that into a good acronym, John? MACJA.
MACJA. MACJA. So, so here's what I would say. Like, I don't think of you guys that way. You probably don't think of me that way, and you probably have tons of guests on and people in your audience. You go like, wait a minute, they're people of faith. They follow Jesus, but they're not mean, angry, condemning. What is this? It's how the media's painted it. Well, because of that, I think what we have to do who are followers of Christ or people who are spiritual or religious is that if we're going to have grace, kindness, favor, love, compassion, we're going to have to go after the normal perception, mean, angry, condemning, judgmental, and we're going to have to do so in a way that just demonstrates God's favor in the everyday of life. I think in my story, I told you a little bit about it. I told God I wouldn't be a pastor or a missionary. In my growing up, those were kind of the things, like if you wanted to really serve God, you'd be a pastor or a missionary. And so here's my question. What percentage of people who are Christians are pastors and missionaries? It's like totally small. It's less than 1%. So what about the rest of us? Well, you're supposed to go to church, pay your tithes and offerings, and maybe you can serve in the parking lot or children's ministry. Now, again, that's awesome. If you serve in the parking lot or children's ministry, I'm good with that.
Right.
But I just got to ask this question. Is that it? Is that like really? Because when I read the New Testament, when I read Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, especially those first five, the Gospels and the story of the early church, whoa, yes. The vision is so different than that. And
way different.
The Bible says they were increasing in favor with the people. Well, why would they increase in favor of the people? I think it's because they were taking care of poor people. I'll give you a fast forward and I'll be quiet. I'll give you a fast forward in American history. A guy named George Whitefield, 1730s or so. I'm not a total historian, but 1730s or so. It was part of what was called the First Great Awakening. He would preach to 10,000 people. But then he'd start a church, a hospital, a school, and an orphanage. And he saw no dissonance between that because, like, there were needs in the community, needs in the region. So he would go after that because you're supposed to bloom where you plant, where you're planted. And I like to say this to sometimes to people, your address where you live, your address where you work, that's actually not an accident. It's an assignment. So Josh, those neighbors who are fighting out in front of you, you know, and just like maybe you fight with your kids or whoever is around your house.
Every now and then.
Yeah. So like, That's who you get to be with. You get to hang with your neighbors. You get to hang with your coworkers and colleagues and people you go to gym with or go, you know, whatever your sports things are or recreation things are, go camping with. That's who is your assignment. It, like, just be Jesus. Be the love of God. Be grace with skin on in the everyday of life.
Yeah, you know, I'm curious and... I want to push back a little bit on your, you know, media's characterization of believers. And mind you, like, I'm a believer too. So,
yeah.
You know, any critique the media offers, like, also applies to me, you know, but it's one of those, like, you know, reporters don't go to the airport to report on planes that land safely, you know? So there is a little bit of, you know, what's considered newsy. Like, don't you think that Christians kind of have at least some part to play in the negative, you know, PR that we get?
Yeah. Yes. And I don't even want to name the name of a church, but there's a particular church that, you know, holds up placards, God hates gays, and holds up placards of, you know, God condemns United States. And you're exactly right. People don't cover safe arrivals of planes or safe train arrivals. They cover crashes. They cover almost mishaps. And so you got Christians out there angrily spewing stuff and that I don't think reflects the heart of God. And that's what gets covered. So 100%. We've got people who are Christians and the body of Christ and are just sometimes very responsible for the way we're portrayed. I do think we've gotten in a world where, and this is a complicated subject, but the line between news and editorial has really gotten blinded. Like, I think a lot of what we receive as news, because we're in such an information, or in much of what we receive as news is in truth editorial. And by the way, that's from the right and the left. I'm not talking about, you know, left wing. I'm talking about the world we live in is so polarized. That a lot of what passes as news is really, at least, you know, I'm 62. When I was growing up, And I know, you know, is there ever such a thing as unbiased news? Who knows? But, you know, 40 years ago, news was in one category and editorial was in another. I think I read articles today. Let me just say this because it might freak some of your listeners out. I read Time magazine and read it since I was 20. I can't tell you how many times I read an article in Time where I go like, whoa, that is not, this is not an objective article stating pro and con and positive and negative. This is an activist article aiming towards a particular objective.
Yes.
But it's printed as news. And I think that's just the world we live in.
Yeah, it's a very unfortunate part. Oh, Will, did you have something you wanted to add in?
No, I was just going to agree with you wholeheartedly. I mean, as one that follows the news fairly closely, but also like I might be a little bit of an outlier because the way I consume news probably isn't how most people consume news. Like I tend to read more of my news than to watch cable news shows.
Dude, you must be old.
and I also rely on Twitter or X or whatever they're calling it now, because I follow reporters that are covering stories that I'm interested in. So yeah. I get real time like news, actually. Like, I mean, you can only editorialize so much in 280 characters, you know, so.
Yeah, totally. And we're trying, part of what we want to do, and we've had guests on here, a few different guests on literacy when it comes to news and social media and digital kind of literacy. What is it called, Will? Why am I forgetting?
What, media literacy?
Media literacy. I don't know why. I said social media literacy. But basically so that, like, you know, when people, like, you know, share an article they've never, you know, they haven't read or they haven't checked or whatever it is. Go ahead, John.
I was just going to say, when like in my role now as a college president, again, something I never planned on, but we always talk about critical thinking. Today, a big part of critical thinking is not finding the information on a subject. It's discerning of the five different pieces that I'm looking at. How do I discern what is true? And does this person have a bias? And this person have a bias? And how do I compare and contrast sources of information? And is this reliable? Is that reliable? And how do I know? Those are life skills for today, because Will, I was sort of teasing you a little bit. I read my news all the time, every day. I have a certain pattern that I do, and it's just how I do it. I get tons of newsletters, so I read a lot, and I'm a really quick reader, so reading's good for me.
Yes.
A lot of my students and even some of our younger staff and faculty, their only source of news might be four different social media platforms. And a lot of their news is visual, like they're watching something. And I get it. I'm not trying to be a Luddite. I'm just saying, hey, okay, that works for you. But when they're looking at those four different video platforms, just as I'm looking at my print platforms, the big question is, do I trust this person on this platform, or do I trust that person on that platform? And what do I do if they all agree? That's actually a challenge. What if nobody in your world disagrees with a particular perspective? And then what do I do if everybody disagrees? How do I manage that? Those are life skills that we need some hacks for in the everyday.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, I was, as you were talking, I was thinking about like my own habits, and I also love to read. I love to that's how I like to ingest the information. If I feel like it's somehow, to me, it's like if I'm reading it, it feels like it's more legitimate, which isn't true. But for some reason, it just feels like it's more legitimate. But jumping back to this idea of grace, and even something interesting that you said, grace and truth, right? Because we want to wrestle with the truth that we have. And you're mentioning critical thinking at how important that is. How do you manage that in a higher education format where, say, it's supposed to be, you know, college is supposed to be the place where you're challenged in all your thinking, where you're taught to think, where you're You're supposed to, you know, learn how to research, learn how to formulate an educated opinion or whatever. How do you manage the tension between grace and truth at that higher academic level, at that higher level, yeah, where you're in your ministry there, in your context?
So good. Thanks so much for that. I'm gonna just start with a very quick story. It was about 9 years ago, maybe 10 years ago, that Jessup started a biology program. And prior to that, Jessup had come out of being a Bible college and a lot of great stuff. We still have a deep commitment to Bible theology and history and humanities and all that. But so we were starting the sciences, might have been 10, 11 years ago. Well, our regional newspaper, which is not a small newspaper, called me and interviewed me with a guy that I had met before. I'm not exaggerating, guys. I spent 1 hour on the phone with him explaining how you could be a person of faith and a person of science. His belief was that if you were a person of faith, you could not be a person of science. And if you were a person of science, you could not be a person of faith. Now, by the way, that flies in the face of all the scientists who are amazing people of faith and all the people of faith who are really rigorous in their science. So here's what I said, and this is what I would, in answer to your question. First of all, everybody has presuppositions. I have a philosophy minor for a background, so I think like this. Everybody has presuppositions. That's that set of glasses I was talking about. So we're really clear at Jessup about the worldview that we operate in. Like, we believe there is a God. We believe that God has revealed himself. He's revealed himself in creation, in the scripture, the Bible, and in Jesus. So God, there is a God. He's made himself known in the creation, the scripture, and in Jesus. That's kind of a core foundation. And by the way, nobody comes to Jessup without seeing this is our basic bias. Now, having said that, bias meaning worldview, having said that, how does that comport with the data? And so what we teach our scientists, and this is what I said to the reporter 10, 11 years ago, I actually disagree so strongly with him. I said, I actually hope that people of faith are the very best scientists because they are committed to a rigorous pursuit of the truth. Because in my view, the more truth we gain about the nature of the world, the more truth we gain about people, the more truth we gain about culture, we actually are seeing more and more and more about the nature and character of God. My commitment to a belief in God doesn't diminish my desire to see and to seek and to understand truth. It actually elevates it. Now, here's where the grace comes in. If God's if there is a God and he's perfect, the reality is we're not. Everybody in human experience would go, I'm flawed and failing, and if you think you're perfect, you probably are not long for, you know, you're probably going to get locked up someday. Because the truth is, we all know. So because we're all imperfect, we all are in need of grace from a perfect and holy God, but we also got to give grace to each other. Another quick story. When I was a boy growing up, my dad was a conservative Republican. This is in the 1960s. My dad was a conservative Republican. My mom was a moderate Republican. Their best friends were liberal Jewish Democrats. They would come to our house probably twice a month for dinner. I saw my mom and dad in 1968. That was a huge tumultuous war, a season in American life.
Yes.
Riots, assassinations, a Democratic National Convention. It was terrible. I saw my parents, who they were apart. They were together, but they had different views. And then their best friends, I saw them eat dinner, fight, and eat dessert. Now I was about seven. I was about 7 years old. That imprinted on me, like, whoa, my parents love these people, and they could not be more radically different. Like, I think we need to recover a lot of that. That's, to me, having grace. You have grace for people who disagree. You have grace for people who mess up. Now, again, I'm kind of a conservative guy, so I think that there should be punishment for crime. I do think that we need to live in, as much as possible, a just society. But, boy, we're imperfect people surrounded by imperfect people. And the Bible says, you know, to the extent that you give it, it'll be given back to you. If you're a person with no grace in your life, you're probably not going to get much grace from other people around you.
Going back to this heaven on earth, phrase that's in the Lord's Prayer, I'd love to get your thoughts on what you think the government's role is or should be in establishing that, you know, in creating kind of this heavenly earth, you know, in which we all live in.
Yeah. Such a great question. And again, I don't mean to, I hope I don't get too historical.
Get as historical as you want, man.
Okay.
You don't have to edit yourself in any way.
Okay. In the early church, there's no record in all of the Bible of Christians being in power. Now, I'm talking about the New Testament, Matthew to Revelation. So I think you guys both live in the U.S. I live in the U.S. Like the world we're living in, however upset with it or happy you are about it, no early church Christians ever lived in a world where they had as much freedom, as much opportunity, as much responsibility as we do in modern day United States of America. So let's just start there. In fact, you read in Peter, Peter's writing to people who are scattered all over the world because of persecution. And we know, 40, 50, 60, 70 was super bad. It also got really bad in the 100s and 200s. So now let me fast forward. I'm going to answer your question eventually, Will, I promise. In 1500, you have the Reformation, and you got all kinds of conversations, and Calvin set up in Geneva, Switzerland, this thing. Okay, here it is. The family has what's called one sphere. The church has a sphere, and the government has a sphere. In other words, he was really specific. If you read his writings, he was really specific about this is the family role, this is the church role, the community of believers, and this is the government's role. Now fast forward to the American Revolution. I think that we've been fighting a war of centralization versus decentralization. And if I could very quickly, I'll do this as quick as I can. On the one hand, I think all of us can say each individual, we need each individual to have some autonomy and sovereignty over their life choices. Will, as much as you like Josh, and I hardly know you guys, but you don't want Josh to be telling you, hey, dude, this is what you're doing at 10:01, and this is what you're doing at 10:05, and this is what you're doing at 11:30. Like, you don't want him dictating your life to you. Like, you want individual freedom. Second of all, we want freedom within, however you want to describe it, households, families. We want some autonomy to say, wait a minute, this is my house, this is my family. You don't have the right, Mr. So-and-so or Mrs. So-and-so, to come into my family house, my safe place, and tell me what to do. There's like, now you go further. I live in California, so you have cities, you have counties, you have state government, and then you have federal government. So America is an experiment in like how much individual freedom, how much control. And so here's where I would go to with the government. Generally speaking, I'm a conservative. Now, that'll make some people happy and some people mad. Generally speaking, I'm a conservative. What do I mean by that? I really think government's primary role is to protect freedom, to protect freedoms of families and individuals. And I think, generally speaking, in the American system, to protect freedom of families and individuals, and to protect freedoms of government responsibility. In the Constitution, in the 10th Amendment, it says powers that are not specifically articulated for the federal government belong to the state government. Mm. Now, it might weird out some of your listeners. I live in California. My state is way more liberal than I am personally, but I accept I live in a state where the state of California has the opportunity to make laws that I might not agree with, but since I live in a democratic republic, if our state legislature makes laws, unless they violate the core tenets of the U.S. Constitution, my state has the authority to do that. So my short answer is the role of government is to protect the freedom of individuals and families. And then we've identified a couple other key things in our Constitution, freedom of people gathering in groups, like religious association, like for protest, the right of people to assemble. And then we've also said we want to protect specifically racial groups. We want to protect free speech. There's just various things where government protects, but its fundamental job is to protect freedom.
Yeah, I love that. That's a really cool. That's a really cool summary, and I would tend to agree. You know, this isn't like the Josh show where I go into my analysis on government. So, but I would say, just as a real short, like snap, that I agree with the statement you just made. But it brings up in me, right? We have these freedoms, and it brings up in me a tension, and it's not a bad tension, but I'm supposed to be an ambassador of grace, which I think, I love the language. I think it's biblical, and I think it's true for believers. So I'm supposed to be an ambassador of grace, right? So I'm going to go over, and I'm going to give grace to my neighbor. I'm going to call them. I'm going to see if there's anything I can do, if I notice something. I'm going to be there to help them and be there to care for them, and my church and my local church. What happens when we go beyond, and you kind of alluded to this, right? It's really easy for me and my family to say, hey guys, this is how we want to worship, this is how we want to do. Moving out of my church, it's not as easy, but it's still easier than moving out into my neighborhood, right? Than moving out into your county, state, town, whatever, however you have it. We're supposed to be these ambassadors, and I agree. The tension, I think, that I found, and the things that I found just in our, you know, for all, just to be completely transparent, like, we've had several people on the show. One guy wrote The Case for Christian Nationalism. We talked with him. It was very, very interesting. We disagreed, both Will and I, but we want to have people that are coming on, and we want people to understand it. One of the biggest things is that when you don't understand something, you demonize it. And then when you demonize it, you have no chance of understanding it because it's evil, right? So you can't. So we're trying to understand it. We've had people come on, proponents and very staunch opponents of things like the New Apostolic Reformation, things like the Seven Mountain Mandate, things like, where does this kind of stuff fall into what you're like thinking about grace and spiritual gifts and how we operate in the marketplace? Is there an intentionality that we have, say, for instance, the Seven Mountain Mandate, where we're like, hey, as Christians, we should gather together and we should aim at, Hollywood, the media, or we should aim at the education system. How does that work? How do you deal with that tension within the idea, which is totally true, that we're to be grace ambassadors, but then how does that flesh itself out, say, in these kinds of like, I don't know if that question makes sense. Oh, I'm kind of rambling now, but you can go on. I see it welling up in you, and I want to hear. Go ahead.
Again, please cut me off if I start going too long. But
you're good to go.
The book is Grace Ambassadors, not Grace Generals. And I think the challenge you're talking about, Josh, is so good. It comes under the notion of, can you legislate morality? So, again, I have super strong convictions on a number of subjects, but 2 Corinthians 5 says we're to be ambassadors of reconciliation. Matthew 5 says that we're to be salt and light. And Jesus himself says, what good is the salt if it's lost its saltiness? What good is the light if you put it under a bushel? So now let me say that, man, I so pray for people to go into Hollywood. I so pray for people to be in government.
Yeah, absolutely.
I pray for people to be in business who love God, who love Jesus, and will be salt and light and be a demonstration of the grace and kindness and love and compassion of Jesus. By the way, what's happening right now with the Chosen TV series, with the Jesus Revolution movie, is that God's starting to use the wooing, the winsome, the loving testimony of people to bring people. Like, the thing that people say about the Chosen series that we just love so much is it lifts up the humanity of Jesus without denying his deity. And by the way, what I also love is it shows that the disciples, and I'm gonna say a word, you might get offended. It shows that the disciples are knuckleheads. And who among us can't watch the disciples?
I'm so offended.
I know. Well, seriously, but you look at that and go like, no, this is Peter, this is John. Well, they're knuckleheads. they're like me.
Yeah. Now,
you know, way more faith than me probably in some ways. But when Peter, especially like in the third season, when he's so angry at God that you do all, Jesus, you do all these things for other people, but my own wife has a miscarriage and where were you? And like, read the Psalms, people. If you read the psalmists are a lot of times saying, God, where are you? So my point in all that is this, man, here's where I personally part company, and I have dear friends on all sides of these issues. A lot of the Seven Mountain Mandate I appreciate and enjoy, but what I reject is what's called dominionism. The idea that it is the will of God for the people of God, not just to occupy, but to take by force those things. In other words, what undergirds Christian nationalism, and by the way, like, you will not meet a more patriotic American than me. I'm so grateful I was born in America. My father fought in the Second World War in the Korean conflict. I honor all veterans. I just am deeply committed to the wondrous gift that is America in world history and right now in our time. So please hear, honor, honor, honor. At the same time, America is an imperfect, flawed, messed up country. It's got messed up people like me as part of it. And our government's messed up, and it's never not been messed up. We live in this imperfect season between now and when we get to heaven. So what I would say is this, man, I want Christians in every office of government and media and all the places. But I believe that believers should be there like Daniel, like Joseph, like Esther, like Nehemiah. Those are the stories we have a Bible full of. We don't have a New Testament where Christians have crushed the oppositions and you know, asserted themselves. We're called to be salt and light. And so I just feel like that bringing heaven to earth is in the everyday reality that will woo people into the arms of Jesus. And that 2 Corinthians 5 passage, by the way, says, where ambassadors of reconciliation, we literally beg people on behalf of God to be reconciled to him. It's maybe I'll close with this. If you found the cure to cancer, I mean, all cancers, you found the cure.
Yeah.
And you did not share it with your friends, your coworkers, everybody that you could who had cancer. Isn't that in some way evil, like wrong?
Yeah.
If we know what it means to be at peace with God, and we don't share that with people in a loving, compassionate, gracious, kind way, literally begging people to be reconciled to God, then I think that we're what the Bible calls in sin. We're in disobedience to God.
I know Will's got a question, but I just love that imagery of begging, because I think that the imagery we get so often is forcing or some kind of coercive, like, and I guess someone could say begging, like in a manipulative way, but if from a genuine heart.
Yeah. Like pleading.
Like pleading with someone.
Yeah.
That is, I love that imagery. And I just wanted to say that that's a really cool way to think about like this pleading idea of like, yeah, we want to be able to share this. So God, we need to be able to do this in a way that reflects our genuine care and concern. Go ahead, Will.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, so we're working on a 5-part audio documentary about Christian nationalism. And one of the episodes, for better or for worse, actually focuses on Trump and kind of how, you know, a broad majority of Christians in this country have kind of hitched our wagon to the Trump train. And you know, kind of to your earlier point about, you know, yeah, like Christians kind of get a lot of bad press because of X, Y, and Z. And I think just sort of the Christian connection to Trump doesn't necessarily help anything, because, you know, I've got lots of non-believer friends that are like, why are you supporting that person in such the way that you are, or the broader group is? You know, I mean, you got folks that are equating him to like a King Cyrus. You know, you've got other people. There's one gentleman in particular who actually thinks that Trump is like a messiah. And so how do you address that, or how do you, you know, maybe the question is, how do you support a candidate without deifying them and open ourselves up to all this bad press?
So good. So good. Let me start by saying a phrase I think one of you used earlier. Whenever we label something, that makes it easy to demonize it. And so I want to be a little careful. Some people think it's Christian nationalism for Christian parents to be involved in the school board, to be involved in the city council, the state legislature,
right,
or be a senator, or be a president. And I just want to be careful, like, hey, wait a minute. It's not nationalism, which is sort of the merging of Christianity and the nation and saying, okay, yeah, Christianity equals United States government. So how do you support a candidate without deifying them? I have a dear friend. His name is Sammy Rodriguez. You may know him or heard about him. Sammy says that he never follows the party of the donkey or the party of the elephant. He makes really clear he's in the party of the lamb. Mm. So I would say this: President Trump, President Biden, President Obama. In fact, I'm going to stop there. I used to go to churches a lot and ask this question right in between Obama and Trump. I would say, how many of you are praying for our president? And people who loved President Obama would go like, yeah. And then I'd ask them shortly later when President Trump became president, how many of you are praying for our president? And those same people would go like, ugh. Or the opposite. I'd ask him, are you praying for President Trump? Yeah. And then I go, well, did you pray for President Obama? No. Folks, that is a systematic problem in the body of Christ. If you're not praying for whoever is president, or on the flip side, if you're believing that President Trump, President Biden, President Obama, President Bush, President Washington, George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, there is no human being who is ever our hope. There's no political party who is our hope. Our hope's in the gospel. Sometimes when you're choosing a candidate that you believe in the policies of that party, you're believing in the positions of that candidate, and you're hoping and believing for them. You will never elect a Messiah for the United States in any form. There's only one Messiah. His name is Jesus. And so I like what Sammy says. It's not the party of the donkey or the elephant. At one level, whether you're Republican or Democrat, are you voting for people whose values are in alignment with biblical principles? Are you voting and supporting candidates, but you're supporting flawed and imperfect candidates and parties? Hope that helps.
Yeah, you know, and it seems like, I mean, based on my experience anyway, it seems like a lot of Christians will support a candidate. I mean, and it makes sense because they are promising to do things that align with their faith. But to the outside observer, it seems as if they're pushing kind of their religion on them, you know, much like, you know, like same-sex marriage, a good example. Yep. You know, I mean, I don't know if there's a non-biblical rationale why same-sex marriage should be legal, and you've got folks kind of on both sides arguing where they stand. I mean, for me personally, I don't have any issues with it, you know, but then you've got another segment of Christians that want there to be laws that outlaw it. So in my mind, I always think like, well, if you have such a problem with certain types of behavior, like you can't necessarily legislate somebody into behaving in a way that you feel is more righteous. You know, Jesus didn't go to Congress and try to make them write laws. He met with them and he prayed with them and he loved on them. And I just really kind of feel like that's what's missing in our political discourse today. So, do you have a comment?
Yeah, a couple of things. Well, love, this is a much longer conversation probably, but I, first of all, love that you have a heart for relationship. Like, why are we throwing firebombs at people that we don't even know? Like, let's be in relationship. Let's have some conversation. It's hard when you're, you know, in a state and it's a federal issue and it's way distant from you. But are we developing relationships with people who are on a school board, city council, state government, federal government? Second thing is this. Remember I said government was to protect freedom. So let me just give you a couple of quick examples. We're all okay with laws against murder, right? Like, you shouldn't have the right to take my life. We're probably for laws against robbery. You shouldn't have the ability to take my stuff. Now, the more hard one would be, are you okay with laws about requiring helmets for motorcycles riding? And depending on where you are with that, you go like, well, yeah, because if you don't wear a helmet and you get an injury, the cost of all that will fall on all of us. So I think the challenge becomes is when we're dealing with social situations where there might be an effect on all of us. And so gay marriage is a big, huge, hot topic. I have strong biblical convictions about that, but I also recognize the culture we live in. I'm very concerned for the long term of our culture. And again, it's a much longer conversation. But as we do let me just say this. There's nowhere in Scripture where God tells us to hate people who disagree with us. And he tells us to hate actions. Like, there are actions where Scripture says that's a destructive action, and he tells us to hate sin, but he never tells us to hate the people. So I think Christians have done a poor job of that. I need to be able to look at people. I'll give you one for me, child molestation. For me, that's just a super hard issue. I actually now have 5 grandkids, got 5 kids, and people who molest children, like this movie out, The Sound of Freedom, is just unbelievably awesome, and it's a great movie. I encourage people to watch it. If you watch that movie, you just go like, oh, how could anybody ever abuse a precious little child? You just like, ugh. But then I have to ask myself, somebody who does that, even though I think what they did is terrible and heinous and awful, can I still have a love for them and want them to be reconciled to God? For a lot of us, that's a hard thing because we just want to, you know, pound them.
It's a very hard thing.
Yeah. So it's a complicated issue. I love your heart for a relationship, though. Will, I appreciate that.
It is complicated, super complicated. And we only deal with complicated issues on this show, which is kind of the part that's fun and also like stressful, because it's like, am I ever going to say something that like in 10 years they're going to come and you said this back and now and you can't. And I just got to be like, I don't know, man. Yeah, sure, maybe. I guess if you got it on recording, then I said it. You know, sorry. By that time, who knows, man, with AI, who knows? I'll just say it's a deep fake, and then we'll be good, dude. And there I'm pulling go. That straight from the Trump, from the Trump playbook. It's a deep fake. I didn't say it. I just want to kind of, there's 2 questions. There's one that's kind of a practical question that I'm super just interested in for you as a president of the, of Jessup University. And then I'm going to ask the last one, just a kind of a closing question for everyone that involves your book and stuff like that. But here's the question. As a president with the tensions, especially in a place like California, How do you manage the tensions being, I'm assuming, a very conservative evangelical institution? How do you manage the tensions of, or are you receiving pressure? You don't have to say whatever, you know, whatever you feel like you can say. Are you receiving pressure? How do you work against that? And what do you recommend, like, people in your position and people like us? Like, how do we manage? Do we need to protect ourselves? Do we need to lawyer up? Do we just need to pray more? What do you imagine is going on here, and how have you experienced it?
Yeah, great question. So I've been president. This is my 13th year. We've had maybe 3 or 4 times during my 13 years where we faced what I would call kind of direct, frontal hostility, not just our school, but schools like ours, from the legislature in California. Every single time, what we've tried to do is be engaged in the process. We do have a political process in America. If we were living in another country, like, you know, let's say you're a follower of Jesus in China, like, you don't have a lot of options. But here in America, we have a lot of freedoms. We have a lot of options. So we can go to the city council. We can go to the state legislature. So we have done that 3 or 4 times. Always full of grace, always just say, look, I'm not going to be here to be spewing stuff at you. I'm not going to be, you know, wagging my finger and condemning, but I am going to contend. I'm going to advocate for things because that's part of what our process allows for us. Thankfully, Josh and Will, we've had the opportunity to be really favored. I think one of the reasons is that we are very engaged in our community. It really bothers me. I should be careful I say this, maybe. It bothers me when Christians are content with being kind of cloistered and disconnected from their neighborhoods and their schools and their cities and their counties. And, you know, like, so I think Jessup's been very involved. We, all of our students are required. That might seem hard, but it's, they're required to give service hours. So we work with homeless, we work with schools, we work with medical centers. We're just, our students are very involved in the community. So I think our community around us, even if they don't disagree with us, I mean, if they don't agree with us, they disagree with us, they recognize the value that we bring. So, you know, I appreciate things like Alliance Defending Freedom and our Pacific Justice Institute. They've been super helpful to us when there are these big, huge issues. But for the most part, we've really felt like the protection of God and the favor of our community. And I think that's really important. If you're a Christian and people in your own community don't think well of you, you might at least ask some hard questions.
If your church is not in
a place serving the poor, you know, being for your community, being for the teachers, or whatever the needs are in your community, like, I guess I have some questions about that, because I read the New Testament that, man, they were, you know, it's a Christian word, they were a blessing. They were they were a gift to their community.
That's so good. Well, John, this is kind of the last one, and you have your latest book. We've talked about it on and off, Grace Ambassadors. And so, what is the one thing, if you could put it in kind of a sentence, or, you know, I'm sure it would be a paragraph, but you know what I'm saying. If you can put it in that succinct way, what do you want our audience to hear from your heart about this book, about even the future as we're moving forward, in life and in this country and trying to navigate the next election cycle and all that stuff? What is your hope? Because we have Christians, non-Christians, atheists, right? Yep. Liberals, conservatives, all sorts of different kinds of stripes that listen to our program. What's your hope for them? And what do you want them to hear from you, your heart?
Great. Thank you for the question. I'll just say you guys have been amazing to talk to. And I just want to encourage, I know you have a link for the book below, but if people want to go to Grace Ambassador, graceambassador.com, you can just get a sample chapter. You can see what other people are saying. But here's the core message. I think the life of faith needs to be lived out in the everyday. And I think from God's perspective, he has a full employment policy. Like, I'm all for pastors. I've been one. I am one. I'm all for people on platforms. That's fine. That's great. But I don't think faith is a spectator sport. I think it's everybody on the field. There's no spare parts. God has a full employment policy. And when you're a Grace Ambassador, it's not because you got some mucky muck title and you're wearing big robes and gotta, you know, that it's that you're in your everyday living out your faith, live out your values, live out your hopes, live out your dreams, and do that in the everyday. And it's always about relationships. John Maxwell says, everything rises and falls on leadership. And I love John Maxwell. He's amazing. Everything rises and falls on leadership. My corollary to that is that everything in leadership rises and falls on relationship. Grace ambassadors are relationship people saying, God, who's in my life? Who are my friends? Who are my family? Who are my coworkers? Who's the clerk at the store? I've been going to the same restaurant when I can for 10 years. Why do I do that? In part, I want a relationship with the servers. I want to be able to know them. I want to be able to give tips to them. In my job, I have to go to a lot of different restaurants, but I try to go back to this one particular one to build relationships with the servers. So
that's so good. I love that. Just that practical tip. And then hearing from you, it's like what I heard was, you know, if you can't lead without influence, and you can't influence without relationship. And if you that'll good. Preach, dude, that did you write that down? Well,
somebody needs to write that down. That's some good
we need to tweak that right now. But thank you so much. How can people keep up with your work, and how can they learn more about Jessup University if they're interested?
I'll give you a couple websites. First of all, go to drjohnjackson.com. drjohnjackson.com. That'll get you all kinds of resources I have. It'll point you to Jessup too. But if you just want to go straight to Jessup, Jessup, JESSUP.edu, because it's a university, .edu. Jessup, JESSUP.edu. That'll get you everything you need to know about Jessup.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, John. It's been such a pleasure having you on the program today. And God bless you, my friend.
Thanks, guys. Loved it.
Absolutely.